throw up my hands, praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah,
took a breath when I doubted. Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter on the canvas and the clay. You make all things work together for my future. Sorry,
but then it's too new. Good talk. But then.
Good morning, FIC. Welcome to church this morning. We're so glad to welcome you in. We are a church that delights in being able to gather together as a family on Sunday mornings and worship in person. And so I'm going to invite the church to stand, and I'll head it over to Brennan to lead us in worship this morning.
Amen. Yeah, let's stand together and start with a word of prayer. God, we just thank you so much for being here. We thank you, God, that you invite us into your presence to worship you, to give you the glory and honor that you deserve. God, as we worship you today, would you come and meet us? Dear God, would you touch our hearts? God, help us to experience your presence and your love today. We worship you, God, and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's worship God today, church. Thank you, God. Let's sing together. You said, and you said, ask and you will receive whatever you need. And you said, pray and I'll hear from heaven. And I'll heal your land. Oh, amen. Come on, church. We worship you, God. You said your glory. And you said your glory will fill the earth like water the sea. And you said, lift up your eyes, the harvest is here, the kingdom is near. You said, I'll give the nations to you, oh Lord. That's a cry of my heart, distant shores and the islands will see your light. It rises on us, you said. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Sit together. You said your glory.
And you said your glory will fill the earth like water the sea. Lift up your eyes, the harvest is here, oh, the kingdom is near. You said, I stand up in the nations.
God, we pray for our brothers and our sisters, dear God, all across Canada, even those around the world, dear God, that they would experience your love, your kindness, your goodness in their lives. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, God. Church, let's continue to worship him this morning. Let's continue to sing of his goodness and his praises in our lives. Thank you, Jesus.
The goodness of God, I'm gonna sing We sing of your goodness today, God. We worship you. We praise you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Yes, God. Yes, Lord. Amen. Church, let's continue to worship him. As we sing this next song, would you receive it as a blessing over your life, over your family, over your children?
Before you and behind you stand beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in the coming, and the going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. Singing in faith today. And amen, amen, amen. Yes, God, we receive you, dear God. We receive your presence, God. Lord Jesus, your love is more than we can ever ask or imagine, Jesus. We thank you, God. Your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Before we're seated, I'd like to just acknowledge if there's anyone here for the first time, I'd like to just acknowledge you here in our church this morning, give you a little gift basket so we can get to know you. Is there anyone here for the first time or visiting? We have a couple people. No. All right. That's your chance. Oh, we do have one somewhere over here on the corner. Hello. Welcome to Leawood International Church. Thanks for coming today. Awesome. Now you know there's a couple new faces and familiar faces. Why don't you turn to your neighbor and greet them? Good morning. And good morning to you at home. Welcome again to Fleetwood International Church. Thank you for coming and joining us today. Just a reminder about our tithes and offering. If you would like to give today, you can give online at our website, fichurch.org/give. You'll find different options to give through PayPal, e-transfer, or credit online. And if you're not very tech savvy, you can still give your tithes and offering through cash or check by using the envelopes there in the back. You can fill those out after the service. Let's head into a time of prayer before we get into our word today. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for gathering us this morning. Thank you so much for church family and the opportunity to just worship you in unity, Lord God, and praise you for all the good things you're doing in our lives, Lord God, and praise you, Lord, for even the tough things that are happening in our lives, God. We know that you are good through it all. Lord, at this time, we'd like to give up our tithes and offering to you, Lord God, that you would bless these resources so that we could multiply our ministries, just not in our neighborhood, Lord, but across the nations, God, and that you would use these resources, Lord, to bless those who don't even know you yet, Lord God, that your name would be glorified to the ends of the earth, God. And as we speak about missions, Lord God, we also pray for our children here, Lord God, the people that you've brought here to the church, Lord God. These are also part of your mission, Lord God, that we would be able to disciple our children in the church, our youth, our students, Lord God. Lord, that you would help us lead them to you, Lord, and that they would know that they are loved and cared for, Lord God. So we bless our children too today as they head into their own church service, Lord. And so we lift up the rest of the service to you, Lord God. May we receive your word with gladness this morning. In your name, amen. So this time, if there's any kids in the service, you are welcome to go to Kid Zone and have lots of fun. Awesome. I'm going to invite the congregation to stand for the scripture reading.
These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey so that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. When the Lord your God brings you into the land he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to give you, a land with large, flourishing cities you did not build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you did not provide, wells you did not dig, and vineyards and olive groves you did not plant, then when you eat and are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Fear the Lord your God, serve him only, and take your oaths in his name. Do not follow other gods, the gods of the peoples around you. For the Lord your God who is among you is a jealous God, and his anger will burn against you, and he will destroy you from the face of the land. Do not put the Lord your God to the test as you did at Massah. Be sure to keep the commands of the Lord your God and the stipulations and decrees he has given you. Do what is right and good in the Lord's sight, so that it may go well with you, and you may go in and take over the good land the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors, thrusting out all your enemies before you, as the Lord said. In the future, when your son asks you, what is the meaning of the stipulations, decrees, and laws the Lord our God has commanded you? Tell him, we were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Before our eyes, the Lord sent signs and wonders, great and terrible, on Egypt and Pharaoh and his whole household. But he brought us out from there to bring us and give us the land he promised on oath to our ancestors. The Lord commanded us to obey all these decrees and to fear the Lord our God, so that we may always prosper and be kept alive, as is the case today. And if we are careful to obey all this law before the Lord our God, as he has commanded us, that will be our righteousness. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's nice to see you today. Well, thank you, Pastor Buena, for reading Deuteronomy 6. Deuteronomy 6 lands so well into our series that we're focusing on the mission of God. And this is week 3 of a 3-part series, and so this will be bringing us to the conclusion of the series today. But looking back, in week 1, we read about and we talked about the meta-narrative of Scripture, and we actually walked through the story of the Bible. And the highlights from that Sunday is the core realities that humanity is powerless under its own power. It is unable to reconcile itself to God. And so there is this spiral of rebellion. There's a spiral of violence. There's a spiral of death that humanity takes when it's left under its own steam. But God has not abandoned humanity to its own spiral. God has chosen to step in and to intervene, and his promise is that he will see the nations restored to him, and his promise is that the nations will be blessed by him. That's the future. That's our experience of God through the story of Scripture. And so we went into week 2, and we started to focus in on the nations, God's mission to reach the nations. And we saw that wherever the Holy Spirit goes, and he goes with us, he goes with us as we go out to the nations with the gospel. Wherever the Holy Spirit goes, it's amazing because it doesn't matter what language is there. It doesn't matter what the cultural background is of the nation or the people that he goes to. Wherever the Holy Spirit goes, things get better. And we can measure that empirically. And so we looked at, you know, why is that? Because wherever the Holy Spirit is, there is now sorrow for sin amidst the people of that nation. There is a desire to have a new mindset that he offers. There's a desire for a change of pattern, for a new pattern of being, of existing, of doing life. And under his supernatural ability, there is regeneration of the person. We become suddenly able to overcome the sinful nature that had kept us spiraling for so long. We also recognize that today, missionary work is carried out largely by churches of the global south, outside of the West, and that rather than coming from a place of power and privilege, the majority of Christian missionary work is carried out in relative poverty. It operates in powerlessness and in the face of opposition and persecution, and yet God's kingdom is growing in the nations. And in that last week, we saw and we had this call that was put out to commit our personal life story to the biblical story of God's purpose for the nation, so that we recognize we're going to be part of it. We want to be part of his big story, the mission of God to the nations. And so now in week three, we move off of our focus on the nations, and we move into another core piece to God's mission, and that's the mission to the next generation. And Deuteronomy 6 is a really important passage for parents to go back to again and again, because it gives a picture of what God would like to see in us as a faith community for passing things down to the next generation, for bringing faith to the next generation and belief in God and obedience to God to the next generation. And so I want to start off by sharing some of the motivation for talking about this. See, Jen and I, we had about 10 years total in the world of global missions. Real focus on reaching the nations. We had about 5 years of preparing to go, and then we had 5 years where we were actively serving in a closed country. And in that time, Jen and I witnessed something that troubled us amidst the missionary community. In a range of mission fields, we saw this too. It wasn't specific to one, but it was in a range of mission fields. But what we saw was that missionaries who were passionate, who were sacrificial, who were dedicated to the call to reach the nations, those who were giving themselves to that purpose in big ways, they had zeal for that, but they were neglecting to reach their own children. And neglecting to focus on their own children. In their zeal for reaching the nations, their kids were missing out on having mom and dad there. And in the most radical form of that, the parents literally weren't in the same country as the country that their kids were growing up in. Mom and dad were all in a different country, reaching people in close places, and they left their kids behind. That was the worst of it that we saw. More commonly, we saw parents who spent their time, energy, and attention on official ministry, and then when they got home, they had very little or nothing left in the tank for their kids. And why that is so concerning to us is that, well, one, it undervalues discipleship of our own children, something that God calls us to. That's a core part of God's mission, the discipleship of our own kids. And it underappreciated God's value for reaching each generation. And so with that kind of bit of a twisted up view, it was an elevation of global missions at the cost of reaching the next generation and their own kids. And you can imagine that kids that come under that would have resentment towards global missions. I know I would. And it's something, it's an attitude that can be imported into ministry that's done anywhere. It's not just out on the mission field. And so one of the things that happens is that within the church, people get very passionate about ministry and being involved in ministry. And that zeal and that passion can lead them to undervaluing time with their kids and discipleship of their kids, and we get that same distorted lifestyle right here at home. And so we're going to talk about this today. And so I want you to know, today is not a guilt trip. Whenever a pastor speaks on parenting, parents kind of walk in, they kind of prepare for the worst of what's going to come at them. And so today is not intended in any way to be a guilt trip. What it's intended to be is a day of equipping. So I'm going to have some recommended resources as we go through the sermon. So parents, if you want some recommended resources to bring into your parenting, just have your phone ready to go so you can snap a picture of the screenshot that'll be up there. I hope to also give us a breakdown of the components that I see making up discipleship of our kids so there can be some clarity. Because when we talk about discipleship, instantly we think of something really formal. And instantly we have a certain framework that we see it through. And so it can leave us with a big question mark. What does it really mean to what's involved with the discipleship of our kids? And third, I want you to give you a vision, and I want to give you confidence to be the intentional discipler. A lot of parents that I talk to, when they come in to talk to me about parenting, they feel a bit lost and feel a bit stuck. They feel like they're in neutral, and they're not confident with what they're doing with their kids in terms of growing the faith at home with their kids. And so I hope to move us out of that feeling, if that's you today. And finally, before we pray, I just want to say this is not just for parents. And so don't tune out if you're not a mom or a dad here this morning. This is also for you cool aunts and uncles. This is also for grandparents. And even if you are one of our volunteers in our Kids or Youth Ministry, I think today should be helpful for you as well. So don't fall asleep, okay? Let's pray into our time. Well, Father, we come to you this morning, and we're talking about, in the framework of your mission, we're talking about reaching the next generation. We're talking about discipleship, and we're talking about discipleship at home. And so, Lord, help us to see your desire for our families, your desire for our parenting, your desire for raising up our kids. And Lord, I pray that there would be a protection from false guilt this morning, that Lord, you would come and just speak your truth, and by your Holy Spirit, give us counsel in how to shape or reshape our family life in accordance with what you want, because we know that you want what's best, and you want to bless our families, and you want to bless the next generation coming up. And so we ask for your help today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I came in this morning prepared with a football illustration, not knowing that, or not realizing that today is the biggest day in football. Brother Ronnie had pointed out to me, oh, today's the Super Bowl. I went, what? It is? And so I don't even have an NFL ball. It's a CFL ball. But today is the Super Bowl. I know many of you. How many of you are going to go eat some nachos and watch the Super Bowl later today? There's a few in the room that'll do that. So, football illustration. I need our manliest man of our church to come up and help me with a football illustration this morning. So, someone that you know, is a strong, powerful, and, you know, in the rich tradition of FIC, wives, you can volunteer your husbands whether they want to come up or not. So who can be our manly man this morning to come up? Anyone out there? Some avoiding eye contact. Come on, volunteer your husband. You'll be helping me out. There's some elbowing going on. I'm not moving on until we get someone. Oh, Brother Rick, come on up. Come on, join me up here. Okay, here, you got the ball now. Now, did you play some football growing up at all?
No, our school couldn't afford a uniform, so we couldn't play football.
No, no money for
we
football.
We played rugby.
Yeah, I heard that for the tape that you use to tape up the like shin pads for football, you can run a soccer team. I've heard those kinds of stats before. Okay, have you thrown a football before?
Yes.
Okay, so if I wanted to, could you like make it into the sound booth over there to launch it? Should these people at the back row, should they trust you in your ability?
Yes, they can trust
me. They can? Okay, yeah. That's great to know. But that's not what I want you to do this morning with the football. This morning, I've got a diaper for you. I want to actually show you guys this. We're diapering a football. This morning's example was so aggressive that the tab broke on the diaper. So I had to call for an emergency backup diaper to come. I wasn't prepared to have two diapers this morning. So this one's a little bit bigger. And for you dads to be out there, When you find out that you're expecting your first child, you get practicing this. You start practicing diapering, a football, you borrow a stuffy from whoever's in your life that has a stuffy, and you start diapering them because you'll need the practice. If you actually want to find out what it's like to diaper a newborn or a young one, you actually should buy an octopus and then try to put the diaper on an octopus. That's a little bit more what it's like. Okay, so you're going to diaper the football as best as you can, and we're going to let you know what we think of it at the end. So go ahead and do that.
So the caveat is we didn't have this. We had pins and a
clock. Yeah.
That's my generation.
Well, that's come back into vogue. Okay, there we go. Now, a big part. Yeah, which side's the front, which side's the back? It's probably been a little while. There we go. And so in first service, I was a little bit taken aback because our volunteer put the ball sideways and then started putting the diaper on. So it's a little bit different view of what the baby looks like. There you go. Okay. Now I know you're laughing back there. This is hard work. This is why you got to practice.
I still have moved the head, so he's still good.
There we go. Yep. Involves some wrestling. There you go. Look at that. Okay, and upon evaluation, okay, first the front or the back to the front ratio is quite good. So when there's those forceful poops that happen, you're not going to get it going up the back. That's pretty good diapering. And we see that the gussets are equal. So well done there, Brother Rick. Thank you. Get there. We're done. Yeah. There we go. Now you know one of the manliest men at FIC. So all of that is so that you have a mental image, something that's going to remind you of this. The reality is that all the things that we do with and for our kids, even our young kids, matters. It matters to God. All that we do for raising up, taking care of our kids matters. Even when it's not the deep spiritual conversations that we frame in our mindset for discipleship, what we do to care and nurture our kids matters. And what we do in the everyday life of raising up the next generation matters. And with our kids, it's a process of discipleship spread out over many days. And so why I bring this up is that related to missions, especially when we get into seasons where we're talking about global missions at the church, there is a lie that we say to ourselves that's quite common, and even some false guilt that comes on us just simply because of the stage of life that we're in, because we have young kids. And it sounds something like this. Well, missionaries, those are the people doing the important ministry work in the world. It elevates that. I'm not doing any of that. I'm just working and raising my kids. Puts yourself down. I'm not doing anything significant for missions. Couldn't be further from the truth. In God's mission, reaching the next generation and reaching the nations are on equal footing. God wants to see both, not one or the other. God wants us to value both. Elevate both in how we perceive our involvement. The reality is that in reaching the next generation, in prioritizing discipling our children, we don't know the impact in future generations that will have. There's no telling. And yet, it consistently has a very big impact on future generations. And the reverse of that is true. When we don't disciple our children, when we don't reach the next generation with the gospel, with the way of Christ, with our faith, things get much worse for them very quickly. Repeatedly in the story of Israel, we have accounts where one generation did not raise up their children to follow the Lord, and then they spiral some more. And And it gets to a point where there's eventually a generation that's forgotten all about God and doesn't even know where they put the book of the law. They don't know where their scripture is. And so today, this morning, I want to speak to that so that in our perception of God's mission, we recognize that reaching the next generation and reaching the nations are both incorporated into God's big plan. And so this brings us to our first recommended resource. And so if you want to snap a picture, now's the time to do it. And the first recommended resource is a podcast, Famous at Home is the name of the podcast. And so this is Dr. Josh and Christy Straub, and their emphasis is on relationship with your kids. Parents, you want to be intentionally building up relationship with your kids. And they talk about topics like discipline. They talk about topics like problem solving. They talk about family rhythms, parenting styles, parenting with grace, which is really important, and just practices and patterns that are going to help your kids thrive. And so there's all kinds of podcasts out there giving out their advice on parenting. This is one that I recommend to you today. So with this worldview that reaching the next generation is really important to God, let's talk about two foundational beliefs about child raising or raising our kids. The first one is this: raising our children is central to the mission of God. Can you repeat that with me? Raising our children is central to the mission of God. It's not something on the side, and it's not something that gets in the way of the mission of God, that's for sure. Raising our kids is central to the mission of God. And I want to look to the life of Timothy in Scripture this morning, that his life highlights for us just how significant and central this is. And so turn with me. We first meet Timothy in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 16. And so Saul has become Paul at this time, and he has been commissioned to go out and start bringing the gospel to the nations, the non-Israelite nations of the world. And so he's taking teams and he's heading out to the great frontiers. And it's going to be tough ministry. It's going to be it's going to require a lot of hardship. It's pioneering ministry. And he meets Timothy, and there's something that Paul sees in Timothy that makes him want to bring him along for this work that he's going to do. So chapter 16. Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was Jewish and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The believers at Lystra and Iconium, and whose father was Greek. I'll just leave it there. So Timothy's mother is a believer, but we find out his father is not. And so he comes up in this mixed home environment where one parent is a person of faith and the other is a person that probably follows after a lot of the polytheistic beliefs that his culture engaged with. And so we find out, too, that the believers in that area spoke well of Timothy. He has a track record before Paul ever meets him. And that's important because we always view Timothy as someone that Paul takes on, and Paul's the one responsible for all the good things that we see in Timothy going forward. But there's a story that goes back before Paul. And so Paul sees something in Timothy and invites him to come and join this missionary team. And to find out the bigger background story of Timothy, we got to go over to 2 Timothy. So turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 1. Let's go there next. Beginning in verse 1, this is the opening of the letter. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, in keeping with the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve, as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Three generations of sincere faith that Paul identifies here. By sincere faith, he means a faith where they are believing God for what he says and they are obeying God for what he asks them to do. And so it begins with the grandmother Lois, then the mother Eunice, and now here with Timothy as well. This faith has been passed on. And the reality is that Timothy is ready for the mission field. This is going to be tough. This is going to be dangerous work. This is going to be work where who your teammates are have to be dependable. And so you don't take new believers on frontier missions work. You don't do that. That's not what happened. And so it was the work and the discipleship of Timothy's mother and grandmother that prepared him, that made him ready to go out to the mission field. And what's really interesting about this example is that even in a divided home where his mother Eunice didn't have the support of her husband in discipleship, she still made it happen in the life of her son. She still chose to raise him up in her faith. And so here we see this great crossover between reaching the next generation and reaching the nations. Because Timothy is raised up in a home that values reaching the next generation, he is then in a place of his faith and discipleship that he can be used of God, partnered with Paul, to go out and reach the nations. And if you continue to follow the biblical story of Timothy's impact and influence, he's an incredible worker among the nations, one of the core people where Paul can trust him again and again and again. And as their relationship grows and matures, their working relationship changes, he's an equal partner eventually with Paul in the mission's work. So here we see this crossover. And so our first foundation is that raising our children is central to the mission of God. It's borne out in Scripture. And the second foundation is that by God's design, parents hold the primary responsibility in the discipleship of children. Do you believe that this morning? Do you believe that? Because it has become a cultural norm for us to farm that out. It has become a cultural norm for us to take discipleship, remove it from the home, and place it squarely on the responsibility of the church ministries to take care of. And so that develops a mindset where parents come and hand off their kids, and where home isn't seen as a place of shaping anymore, as a place of development of faith, where parents don't look at themselves as gifted of God and responsible being given the responsibility and trusted place to disciple their kids. And so God has created the family unit for this purpose. And I want you to know that our children and youth ministries here at IFIC are supplemental to parental discipleship. They're in addition to the discipleship that God wants you doing inside your home. Now, this is the part where parents are going, man, is he going to start beating us up now? Mm-hmm. No. No, not at all. But we have to reshape our thinking for our internal culture of the church, that we want to hold on to the core value that discipleship starts in the home. Discipleship is primarily from mom and dad in the family unit, with the support of other family members as well. Because here's what the underlying reality is that mom and dad, you are irreplaceable. You are irreplaceable in the lives of your kids. You hold a special and unique position given of God that will allow you to set your kids up for success, to allow you to raise faith in your kids in a way that no one else can. You're uniquely empowered and positioned to do that. And that extends out to grandparents as well, but mom and dad, it begins with you. And so mom and dad, in that spirit, we have our second recommended resource for you today. And the title is Keeping Your Kids on God's Side, is a book that we recommend. This isn't a book that you read to your kids. This is a book that you read so that you can be engaged and you know how to talk with your kids, how to have conversations, to equip them. And so this will help guide you in your conversations that you have with kids with the subjects and questions that they have that come up. Why do we believe what we believe? Why do I have these doubts about our faith? You will be better equipped for reading this book and how to have those conversations, whether it's around the dinner table, whether it's when you're out one-on-one time driving in the car as they come up. This is a book that helps to equip you. So we recommend it. I recommend it to you. So now we come to a place where we talk about what is one of the biggest challenges that we face in our culture here today in, we'll say Surrey, but in the Lower Mainland to discipleship. What's one of the biggest things that feels like it just restricts us? And personally, I think it's time. I think it's how much time we feel like we have in our lives, in our weeks, in our days. Our days feel so incredibly full that we wonder, one of the things that probably comes to your mind is, when would I ever have the time to do this with my children? When would I ever be able to fit it in? Parents, I want to begin by encouraging you to value the time that you have with your kids above the money that you have in your pocket. Value the time that you have with your kids above the money that you have in your pocket. Why? Well, two reasons. One is, when I have been visiting with seniors in the seniors' home, to this day, I have not had a single senior look back on their life and say, you know what, I wish I had spent more time at work, more hours at work, taking on more shifts than time with my family that I spent. That's never happened. They've been very clear about that. But in my office and in speaking with seniors who look back on their life, I've met a lot of parents who have regretted not being there for their kids. I've met a lot of parents who have regrets about how much they focus on work instead of the relationship. And it costs them relationship to their child, or in their absence, the absence of the parent, their child was harmed in some way. And so I want to begin by, when we talk about time, value your time with your kids above money. And so, talking about time, well, what kind of pressures do we face on time here in 2023? Well, here in Vancouver, the first pressure is the pressure of providing in 2023. Because the reality is that working wages have steadily dropped. The value of the wage has steadily dropped over the decades. Year after year, it just goes down a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. And at the same time, the cost of living and inflation goes up a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. So we find ourselves in this distorted place where mom and dad have so much pressure on them to work like never before, just to keep the household running. It hasn't always been that way. I want you to know that. It hasn't always been that way. And so that pressure to work is taking time away that families used to have together, downtime as a family. And so those worker wages have steadily fallen. And the pressure to work more hours for both mom and dad have really increased dramatically. And so what do I encourage you with then? It's going to sound like I'm backtracking what I just said about money, but I encourage you to push hard for your benefits at work. I would say that push hard for your benefits of days off, vacation days off, and push hard to maximize the salary that you receive at your work. Because if you steward that right, your increase in time off and your increase in wages coming in, that allows for more time spent with your kids. The stronger your worker benefits are, the more time you can have with your kids. And so I encourage you to push for that. Second is, what's another time pressure that we have? It's the pressure to be involved in everything. We have a culture that tells us that in raising our kids, your kid better be in sports, your kid better pick up a musical instrument, your kid better study another language, your kid better be getting extra studying outside of school hours. And so our kids get signed up for everything. And then as a family, we have a life on the go, don't we? Where we go from one event to the next, and we put those miles on the car, and we get stressed out, we get tired, and our kids get tired from it. So I want you to say that downtime is valuable as a family. Recognize the value of downtime. Days where you intentionally reserve it to do nothing together. Downtime is really important for the development of kids. It's been studied. Downtime is really important. And so carve out downtime, reserve it, protect it in your schedule. And third, I would just say that the other constant pressure that is different from what we grew up with, what we grew up with, is the constant presence of internet access. Because what that does is the devices that we have fill in any of the voids in time. Oh, you have a spare minute, better jump online. Your kids have a spare minute, they're going to be online. That's become more normative. I'd love to do a survey that, you know, how many of you multitask when you go to visit the loo, you know? Because that gives us an idea of how much pressure there is to always be plugged in online. And so we have these pulls on our time. And yet we want to highly, highly value time with our kids. And so, by God's design, parents hold the primary responsibility in discipleship of children, and that comes down to time spent. And so we want to make that happen. Looking at the components that make up discipleship, I want to get back to worldview, because worldview matters. Worldview matters because it determines how we see ourselves for your kids, how they see themselves. It determines how we see and we treat other people. That is all dependent on our worldview. And worldview determines what paths we'll take in life. It's extremely important for our kids, what worldview they have. So turn with me. Romans 12 talks about the importance of worldview in our faith. Beginning at verse 1. This is Paul writing. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. If we give our children a worldview of faith, they will be able to receive that guidance from the Lord. And that is a great gift. And so I want to give you a discussion question now. You're going to turn to the people that are around you, beside you, in front of or behind you. And here's the question. Outside of you, mom and dad, what are the biggest shapers of your child's worldview today? And if your kids are raised up, what are the biggest shapers of your grandchildren? What are the biggest shapers of your niece or your nephew? What are the biggest shapers of their worldview outside of mom and dad today? Go ahead and discuss that. Okay, have you been the one sharing? Maybe flip it around and listen to the opinion of the other person now. Okay, we'll bring that to a close. I know that's been a good discussion. Good. Well, hey, that was a popular discussion. You guys didn't want to stop. So when you're watching the Super Bowl today, when there's commercial breaks, that's what you do. You continue the discussion. So I'm really interested to find out, what are you seeing? What are you thinking? What are the major influences of our children and their worldview. Go ahead and just shout them out. What did you have to say? Okay, school. School's a big one. Yep. Friends. Social media. Okay. Would you break down the social media into different categories? TV. Okay. YouTube. Games. Yeah. A real important one about games now is that when we grew up playing games, moms and dads, it was just the worldview of whatever the creators of the game was. You know, the game that we were playing. They had a little worldview in that game we were playing. Now, when our kids play games online, there's a whole community that they're on the mic with, that they're engaging with and talking to. And so those peers are there now. Yeah. Any others that came up? Government, okay. Brother Rick, yeah. Yeah, he's not wrong about that. Jay, I missed that one. Okay. Yes, there's several. So let's talk about school first. So with school, there is a worldview that gets taught at school. And the worldview comes from the BC Ministry of Education. There is a desired outcome, a desired worldview of what a student will have and hold and... I want to use the word treasure, that's not correct, and value. When they graduate, there's a set of values that the BC Ministry of Education wants students to have as an outcome. And so it's really important, mom and dad, because your kids spend how much time at school every day? In class. It's important that you find out what that worldview is that's desired by our Ministry of Education. And then to do the work of whether you want that your kid to have that worldview. Because your opinion, your desire for your child matters more. Okay, school, there's one part which is the official classroom stuff. But I would say that in my education, that wasn't the most influential at school. It was my peers, my buddies. But that's what I was shaped the most by. There's one standing right behind the window over there. Yeah, they're peers. They're getting worldviews from the kids that are around them. That's right. Okay, online content. Who said online content? Or just in your conversations, did online content come up? Yeah, of course it did. There's some real amazing numbers when it comes to online content and just how much engagement our kids have with it. So there was a survey done by, it's called A Wired Family, done in 2022, and the survey went all the way from preschool-age kids up to teenagers, and what they found is that 75% of kids are using their phones overnight. That means kids are alone with their phone in the bedroom. That phone connects out to anyone and everyone to be alone in that room with the kid. 75% of kids are doing that. 40% of kids are using their phone now after midnight. After midnight. Yeah, teenagers need their sleep. I came up before there were any phones, and I still felt too tired to stay awake at church on Sunday morning. I just need a lot more sleep. So how is that impacting kids in terms of their ability to study, ability to function, their growth, their health? Let alone their worldview. Most kids are spending 5+ hours daily on social media and online video games. Kids and teens with devices average 91 minutes a day watching TikTok. I feel like I'm getting old now because I almost said the TikTok. 56 minutes per day on average for YouTube. And parents, what you need to know about these online platforms is that the content that your kids are seeing is not all up to their decision-making. These are curated algorithms where the companies decide what your kids are exposed to, what they see, what videos are recommended next, what to get your kids interested in. And this is such a powerful industry with so much money being thrown at it that, I mean, we've talked about this before, the ability to predict what you're interested in, it leaves almost a spooky feel to us. that, oh, we were just talking about that, and now there's a commercial for it, right? And so these are not neutral things. These are engaging with and shaping your child's worldview. You want to know what those worldviews are. And you want to be careful how much access you give your kids to being online. And you especially want to be careful that your devices don't become your babysitters, because those are babysitters that will set a different worldview from the worldview you want your kids to have. So, that's the don't do this. Now let's go into good practices. Creating rhythms in our homes is a big deal. And one of the rhythms that I want to recommend to you, and that you're going to go, of course, Pastor Evan would recommend this, but it's old school. I want to recommend to you the rhythm of Bible reading in your home. Because through God's Word, He's going to shape the worldview. Through God's Word, we pass down our faith to the next generation. It's a core component to reaching the next generation. And so we want to have patterns in our home where we're reading the Bible. And my recommendation is that you go old school and get a paper Bible for you. You get a paper Bible for your kids, because I can't get any notifications on here when I have it. When I'm reading on my phone, I get the emails come in, text messages that come in, prompts that come in, and it totally interrupts me. Go old school. Get a paper Bible. And so what I recommend is that we start this off young. And so when your kids are toddlers, little ones, and you're doing the bedtime routine, kids love to be read to, and it's so good to read to your kids. They acquire so much vocabulary by mom and dad reading to them. It's good for their development. But pick up books that tell the story of the Bible and get those stories in your child's developmental worldview. Get those stories into your child's life. And so this is one that we have right now for our kids, The Spirit of God. And it's just the illustrated stories of the different times from the Old Testament and New Testament when the Spirit was at work. But there are many other ones that are great, where it tells the big narrative of the Bible to your kids in ways that they can understand. And so make it age appropriate. You're not helping out your kid by passing your four-year-old a King James version of the Bible. It's going to look cool, you know, for your photos, but it's not going to do much for them. Make it age appropriate. And so for your kids that are 12 and under, I recommend getting a children's Bible for them. Resource them with a children's Bible. These are easy to find. And they have fun facts and they have interesting articles to keep your kids engaged. And so what you do is that as a family, for this rhythm of Bible reading, you take 15 to 30 minutes as mom or as dad, and you have Bible reading time where you gather in your living room. You gather, you hang out around the kitchen table. You choose whatever the space is, and you begin to read the Bible. You let your kids read the areas of the Bible they're interested in, and you do your own reading. The big part here is that you don't tell your kids, go to your Bible reading, and they never see mom and dad do it. You lead them in it. And in this way, they begin to hear from the Lord for themselves through His Word. And what's really, really great is to also add to that, as the kids get older, hand them a journal. And then as they do their Bible reading, get them a habit of just writing down thoughts that they have. Because they will be reflecting on the worldview that God has for them. And the most powerful piece of this is to remember, you're not parenting alone. You are not. The Holy Spirit of God is parenting with you. And He's just as passionate about reaching your children, reaching the next generation, as He is about reaching the nations. And so He's going to empower you in those moments to have that study and have those conversations with your kids. He's going to equip you in how to have the conversations. And one of the best moments as a parent that you'll have is when your child is doing their own Bible reading or maybe have a little bit of journaling, and the Holy Spirit will speak something into their inner world Himself. And you'll recognize that it's from the Spirit, that it's Him leading them. And so you open their life up to the leading of God's Spirit. And that's a great gift to give your kids. And so that leads into our third recommended resource and final resource, of the day, and that's this book, The Radical Book for Kids. It's the right type of radical, not that other kind of radical. The Radical Book for Kids. And the reason why I recommend it to you today is because it is highly recommended by two of my favorite people. Grace and Annabelle love this book. And so they recommend it to you this morning. And what I love about it is it goes into church history. It goes into big questions about how to read the Bible, big questions, regular questions that kids have about God. And it's really engaging, really interesting. And so I want to invite you, for any parents that want to after the service, you're welcome to come flip through our books. Have a look at them before you order them so that you can see for yourself, okay? But that's another recommended resource. So the first component in discipling our kids is shaping that worldview. Worldview matters. And the second component of discipling our kids is setting patterns of life, modeling life for our kids. And so this is where we really get to see God's design for the family unit. Because your kids, my kids, they're always learning. Whether they're in school or out of school, they are always learning. They've been described as sponges, and that's right. They're picking up things by osmosis, by just being beside you. And so they are watching you and learning from you in their daily interactions with you as a family. How do mom and dad deal with their own sin? They learn from you. How quickly do mom and dad own up when they've done something wrong and apologize? They learn from you. They learn your attitudes and they learn your interactions with other people. And for our kids, everything that they see their parents do, that's a green light to them to do. That's a green light. We had, there was a moment of discipline not too long ago where just talking to one of our kids and they said, "But Dad, I heard you say that." And I went, "You're right. I did say that." And they totally pick up on the pattern that we set. It's the green light for them. And so they see when we struggle, will we go to blame or will we go to sitting in shame or will we take responsibility? And they pick up on our efforts to care for people. They learn these patterns from us by simply being beside us. And so Jesus did this with his disciples. And that actually goes back to what Deuteronomy 6 is talking about. And Jesus taught, but he led by what he did. And the disciples picked up what to do by being beside him. And that's a model that we have as parents. And so are our kids seeing us doing what we're telling them to do is really important. And I can illustrate for you how significant this patterning of life is. When you as an adult are under stress, when you come up into either relationship stress or situational stress, the first impulse that you have is whatever you saw your mom or dad do. That's the core impulse that's in your heart of hearts. And that's what we pass on to our kids. And so it can work two ways. If our parents set a positive example for us, then it makes it easy for us to do the right thing in those situations because it's our first impulse. If it's a negative example, negative pattern, then we as adults, we have to wrestle with it. We have to take captive thoughts and make it obedient to Christ. And so with the design that God has given, by patterning, we have a real positive opportunity to make life much easier for our kids in their future, if we can pattern those things. So set the example of the things that you want to see growth in your kids. Now, teenagers, I want to talk to you for a moment, or maybe more about you, I guess. Any teenagers in the room age 14 to 19 right now? Anyone there? Yeah, raise your hand. You dead one like this. I saw. There we go. Okay, did you know that you guys have a superpower? You do. You possess a superpower that the rest of us do not have. You don't know what it is yet, do you? And moms and dads, we all had the superpower as well, going through that age. And here's the superpower. Teenagers are amazing at detecting hypocrisy around them. They do. They pick up on it. When someone's talk is not matched by their walk, teenagers know it. And they hate it. And this results in a lot of interesting discussions with mom and dad through those years. But I think it's a developmental thing, because God is shaping you so that as you go into adulthood, you have discernment. You can be discerning when someone's trying to deceive you. And so it's a good thing that you have that superpower and that you're learning how to use it. But it becomes really important for mom and dad, because in our parenting, you cannot go into teenage years with the idea of do as I say, not as I do. Teenagers will reject that big time. You have to go into the teenage years, and I recommend all the years, with the ambition of do as I do. That is what needs to be at the core. Now, the do as I say, not as I do, I think, I don't know where that even comes from, but maybe it's from a good heart that recognizes that, you know what, I don't do all the things that I know are right to do, and yet here's the right way forward. You know, if it's from a good heart like that, or if it's from a lazy heart, it's like, do that. Don't worry about what I do. Just do that. Yeah, I'm not sure. But again, with our teenagers, it's so important that we engage with example, because they want that authentic piece of setting example from mom and dad. And so as we come towards the end, I want us to recognize as parents that discipleship is not like a switch that turns on and off. It's not an easy thing to do. It's an investment that we have to do, and there's a cost to it. And I'd like to turn to Luke chapter 14, and I would just like to be reminded that there's a cost to being a disciple of Jesus, and I think there's a cost to raising disciples of Jesus. Large crowds, so Luke 14, verse 25. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, now remember, whenever there's a large crowd following Jesus, he's going to say something that they're not going to like. He's going to thin out the crowd. If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. And remember, this was speaking to the idea of people who grew up in clans. And to follow Jesus, you'd probably have to likely turn from the way of your clan that you grew up in and do the unpopular thing in your clan in order to follow him. You'd have to love Jesus more. And so we can bring this in and parallel it to our lives today and saying that, well, we belong to a culture that doesn't follow the way of Jesus. We are part of a culture that has worldviews that is not the worldview that Jesus had. And so we have to be willing to love him more and follow after him. Verse 28, suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, this person began to build and wasn't able to finish. Mom and dad, you're going to have to take some time. Grandma and grandpa, if you have the grandkids in your home, you need to take some time to have planning meetings of what discipleship can look like for that generation when they're in your home. You're going to have to take the time to plan. You're going to have to take the time to be intentional. It's going to cost you time. Or suppose a king is about to go out to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, those of you who do not give up everything you have cannot be my disciples. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown away. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. I want to take a moment just to pray. And I want to take a moment where we just go into prayer and give an opportunity this morning that if the Holy Spirit wants to speak something specific to you, that he can on this topic. And so let's just go into prayer and let's take that time. Heavenly Father, we come to you in this moment And we believe in the presence of your Holy Spirit with us. And we believe that he is the great counselor. We believe that he is the one who will bring to mind the teaching, the thoughts of Jesus. And so we come to you, Father, and we ask that by your Holy Spirit, you would speak into our lives as moms and dads, as grandpas and grandmas, as aunts and uncles. And Lord, would you speak into our minds and hearts this question, the answer to this question? What will I need to reprioritize in order to disciple my child? What will I need to let go of, and what will I need to engage with? And Father, we just ask that by your Spirit, you would speak to that this morning. And so if you've had something specific come to mind, I encourage you just to write it down so you don't forget it. Write it in your phone, write it in on a piece of paper, write it down. And Lord, we just thank you that you care so much for our kids, that you love them so much. Amen. Well, I want you to be aware of how the church comes alongside you, mom and dad, and our part in discipleship of this next generation that's coming up. And so first, I want to point to our kids' ministry. Yeah, Kids Zone. Your kids are back there right now. And I want you to know that Hanalee, our director, she is so intentional about the curriculum that comes into Kids Zone. Your kids are getting a biblical worldview when they're here. I want you to be confident of that. And our volunteers are shaping in a fun way this growth of a Christian worldview that will help set a foundation for our kids. But remember, that's coming alongside what you're doing at home. Next, I want to talk about Awana. Awana is our midweek program. And again, this is bringing our kids in and engaging them with God's Word, helping them to get it into their hearts. And that creates space for the Holy Spirit to speak to our kids and to shape them, give them a good conscience as kids. Many great benefits. And Awana has a ton of fun. My favorite thing is they pull out the giant, it's like a three-direction rope that they have. And the kids, you know, have these big rope poles that go on. I love coming in and seeing that because they've just had a great time of being in God's Word, and there's all kinds of fun activities that they do as well together. Next, I want to talk about summer camps. If you have a niece or nephew or a grandchild who comes from an unchurched home, this is one of the best opportunities to bring them in and give them an experience of church. And so when we run our summer camps, the weekly summer camps going into the summer, be intentional to make those invitations and make it happen so that the unchurched children who are in your sphere of influence can come and have an experience amidst the church family. And finally, we of course have our youth ministry with Pastor Buena. And there's so much going on in youth ministry that I can't outline it all this morning. But again, the goal is to shape discipleship amidst our youth. And finally, I'm going to turn to one final passage of Scripture this morning. And this connects back to Timothy again. I want to turn to 1 Corinthians 4:17. You see, sometimes God brings us into very special relationships in our church family. And sometimes when we don't have a mother or father who raised us up in the faith, the Lord provides for us a spiritual mother or a spiritual father for us to go forward with in life. And that's what happened with Paul and Timothy. Listen to how Paul describes Timothy. "For this reason, I have sent to you Timothy, my son, whom I love, who is faithful in the Lord. He will remind you of my way of life in Christ Jesus, which agrees with what I teach everywhere in every church." Maybe you didn't have the opportunity to be raised in a Christian home. Maybe your mother and father weren't people of faith. I believe that as you seek to disciple your children, one of the best things that you can do is you can find someone who's a little further along in their walk, who may be a generation older than you, and express your desire to have them shaping you and discipling you as you disciple your kids. One of the greatest gifts that we can receive is a spiritual mother or father that we wouldn't otherwise have. And it can help us in our discipleship of our kids. And so we can't go further into that because we're out of time this morning. But if God puts that on your heart, you know, usually it comes about where the Lord puts someone on your heart to go and speak to and to be specific about what you're looking for. Those are good relationships that we want to build up in our church family. Can you say amen to that? I want to invite up the worship team. And as a final encouragement to you parents, I know that there's a lot of fear out there over raising kids in our current climate, our current cultural climate. There's a lot of fear over what they're taught at school. There's a lot of fear over what they're exposed to online. And we, of course, need to live and parent with wisdom. But be encouraged by this. God is not surprised by the time that we live in. God is not surprised by the season that we are parenting in. And His promise to us is that raising our kids up in the faith is that the power of the Spirit that goes out to the nations is also at work in the lives of our kids and can overcome the sinful nature that's at work in the world. Be encouraged and God bless you. Let's stand and worship.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Evan.
Your name, bless your name, Jesus. And the deeds of the day, and the truth in my way, speak of you, Jesus. For this is what I'm glad and do. Time to live a life of love that pleases you, and I will give my all to you, surrender everything I have and follow you, I'll follow you. Lord, will you? Lord, will you be my vision? Lord, will you be my guide? Be my hope, be my life, and the way. And I look not for riches, nor praises on the earth. Only you be the first of my heart. This is what I'm glad and do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything I have and follow you. I'll follow you. Come on. I'll follow. I'll follow you. I'll follow. And I'll follow you. I'll follow. And I'll follow. And I'll follow you. I'll follow. I'll follow you. This is what I'm glad and do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything I have and follow you. I'll follow you.
Yes, Lord, may that be our response this morning, Lord, that the words that we received this morning through your word, through the scripture, through the sermon, Lord, may we apply it to our hearts and follow you. In your name, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated as we have a couple announcements for you this morning. First, there will be a worship and prayer night happening on Wednesday, February 22nd at 7:30 p.m. There will be a time of testimony sharing, so if you'd like to share your testimony, please let me know, contact me, or you can email me at lauren@fichurch.org, and you can come and share your testimony during our worship and prayer night. This worship and prayer night will be replacing the Zoom prayer meeting that happens on Wednesdays. We also have Improve Your Serve, which will be held at Brookswood Baptist Church in Langley on Saturday, February 25, from 9 to 1:30 p.m. And this event is open to everyone, to ministry leaders, to volunteers, to help equip you for the ministry you do at your church. It's $20 and it includes lunch, and you can check out all the details and register at bcbc.ca. There's going to be baptisms happening on Sunday, February 26th. So if you'd like to be baptized, please contact the church office. We also have a women's ministry event happening on March 4th from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. at FIC. Our sister Aileen Tulud will be showing us some tips and tricks for cooking some delicious food. And then you all get to sit down for a feast to eat that delicious food. The cost is $10 per person and seats are limited, so please sign up in the foyer. Last but not least, we have our Youth Valentine Special happening on February 18th.